Joining us from Nyack, New York. He's not from Nyack, New York. He's in Nyack, New York, which is one of the most beautiful spots in the world. He is headlining Levity Live in Nyack, New York this Friday and tomorrow, Saturday. Alonzo Bodden. Hello there, Alonzo.
What's up, David? And you know, you're right about Nyack. It's funny. I grew up in Queens. I'd never been up here. And it was like, oh, so this is what happens. You cross the George Washington Bridge and there's a sign that says Palisades. And it's beautiful over here.
Mm-hmm.
Little two-lane highways and the whole, yeah. So this is, yeah, it's nice. It's going to be a great weekend.
It's going to be a great weekend. It's beautiful this time of year. I would assume the leaves are just popping.
Just starting to bud. So it's not green yet, but green is coming. I'll tell you what's unusual right now, David. L.A. is green. California is green. The last few years, we've been pretty brown, but we had record-setting rain over the winter. It's really funny. It's like, all the hills are green. Well, you know. It's that's what's unusual. So, yeah, so we're greener than the East Coast for now.
I don't want to violate your privacy, but as I remember, is it fair to say you live near Calabasas?
Not too far. I'm in Studio City, so I'm 10 miles from Calabasas.
Was there a time that you lived out there? Because I remember you used to take the motorcycle in for
auditions. I ride up there. I ride up through Calabasas and Malibu Canyon and all of that. Yeah, I love riding my motorcycle up there. Beautiful.
You grew up in Queens. I grew up in Englewood, New Jersey, and I left early on, moved to California, and I knew that there was a life in New York that was exceptional, even better than in L.A., but there was nothing I had to offer the New York metropolitan area to allow me to stay here. And now that I'm back...
Interesting way to put it.
Yeah, I just couldn't make a living. I couldn't make a living in New York. Do you feel like, maybe I should move back to New York because this would be a better lifestyle than California?
It never crosses my mind. Every time I visit New York, you know, my family's still here. I'm like, I love visiting New York, but no, I'm a West Coast guy. I love the West. I love the space. I love the weather. Like you said, I'm a motorcycle guy. Motorcycle and car culture is big out there. But it's just something about the lifestyle. I like the L.A. lifestyle versus New York lifestyle. No, nothing wrong with New York. It's just not me. I'm glad I grew up here. I think the education of growing up in New York is like nowhere else. But I love living in L.A.
Where'd you start doing stand-up?
L.A. L.A. is where I started
now,
in 93.
You started in 93. You used to make airplanes, model airplanes, and then you destroyed your brain from the glue, right? Right? That's
like a Wikipedia version of my story where you ever look on Wikipedia and find out things about yourself you didn't know? Like, hey, I didn't know that. Okay. So I built model airplanes and I sniffed airplane glue. Yeah, why not?
I found out I host a podcast. You made airplanes, right?
I did. I worked on real airplanes. And it's funny because I learned to do that in New York. I went to aviation high school in Long Island City. And I was hired by Lockheed Aircraft in Burbank. So I moved to L.A. And, I mean, I literally got there and just never looked back. And, for the first, 13 years, I spent 10 years building and fixing airplanes and then 3 years training people and having fun making them laugh before I crossed over. And, you know, back when we built them, we never thought to make the aisle wider so that when you beat a passenger and drag him off the plane, there would be more room, like you could comfortably drag him versus having to twist the body to the side to drag it. See, the engineers just don't think of these things. How horrible was that?
What do you mean you built airplanes? Because I know we've talked about this before.
I literally built, you know, the main airplane I worked on was the original stealth fighter for your listeners. If they want to Google it, just Google F-117.
You built a stealth bomber?
No, not the bomber, the fighter. The fighter was used in
for
the first Gulf War. No, it was an attack plane, but it wasn't considered a bomber because it only could carry two missiles at a time. Or I think they could put four smaller ones, two big ones or four smaller ones. But the big thing about it, it was the first airplane that radar couldn't see. It could fly through a radar area. And you're old enough to remember. Remember a movie called Firefox with Clint Eastwood?
I'm going to pretend that I'm not old enough. Who's Clint Eastwood?
Okay, let me refresh. There was a movie. It came out in the early 80s, and the plot line was that Russia had invented this top-secret airplane that you couldn't see it on radar, and it was silent, and it would project false images of itself, and it had no heat trace, and it was basically an invisible airplane. And the idea was for Clint Eastwood to steal this airplane from the Russians so that the Americans could make the technology, blah, 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 right? Well, when that movie came out, we were actually building a plane that could do all of that, and it was top secret. And oh, we're like, can we tell anyone? Can we tell anyone that we actually know that? Like, we make one of those?
Wow. You know?
And the cool thing, the full circle experience, was around 98, 99, I was doing a show in Kuwait, and I was at the base where they kept these planes because they used them, like I said, in the first Iraq-Kuwait war. And when we got there and they're showing us the plane and I start talking about it and they're like, hey, wait a minute, how do you know all of this? And I was like, well, kind of knew it before you did, young man.
So you came to work to make a stealth bomber or a stealth fighter. Could you find it every day? I mean, was it easy to spot?
No, it's an easy joke. It's an easy joke. It's right there. Yes, we did find it. I will tell you, this is how secret that job was, okay? You're too young to remember this,
but your
older listeners will remember. Big scandal about the $600 toilet seats and the $1,000 hammers.
Yeah.
And all of that.
Well, I remember that.
What that was, that's how they, and I learned this later, that's how they finance secret projects, right? So you have this, we were in like an assembly line in a building.
Wow. That's amazing.
Yeah, it's all sealed up. Like once we went to work, like you went into work and they closed the door and you couldn't leave until the end of the day. It wasn't like you could go in or out or anything like that. So what they did was they had an assembly line of a plane that the government knows about, that people know about, and you do a bunch of overcharges on that one to pay for the secret one that people don't know about. And that's how they finance these projects. Well, that's how they used to finance these projects. Who knows what's going on now, but yeah.
Wow.
So when they talked about a $600 toilet seat, it was like, well, actually it's an $8 toilet seat, and $592 is going to finance the, you know, secret military project.
You know, I just remembered a joke from my act. I apologize for bringing this up, but Reagan was president, and I remember there was like a $700 coffee maker. Mm-hmm. And this is like, I just started doing comedy, and I said, you know, for $700, I want that coffee maker to brew it and blow me. And it worked at the time because I was starting. But you know, they can't audit the Pentagon, and I guess that's why, right?
And that's how they do it. And you know who, when that plane, when it was declassified, the person who gave up the secret was a congressman. Some congressman wanted to prove, like, this is what we, you know, this is what we do, this is what we authorize. And he was like, look at this badass plane we've been building. And everybody was like, you weren't supposed to mention that, you know.
So you had top secret clearance. What's that like? Do they investigate
you? For me, it was actually very easy because they check back to when you're 18, and I started at Lockheed when I was like 18 and 3 weeks. So the funniest thing about that was I moved to California, and then 2 weeks later, I got friends in New York calling me like, hey, man, what'd you do out there? The FBI was asking about you.
So they
do the background check and the FBI, you know. I mean, again, I'm a kid just out of high school, so there wasn't much to investigate. There wasn't much trouble I could have gotten into at that point. But, yeah, they did the background check and the whole thing, and I had the secret and then the top secret clearance.
By the time you were 18, you were making airplanes.
Yeah. It's an amazing – when I look back on it, I mean, it's what I did, and I had a bunch of friends from high school, and we all did it. We just had sort of a reunion out in L.A. of the guys who stayed in California and who are making. But yeah, when you look back on it, it was ridiculous. Like, we had just learned to build planes in high school, and now we're building the most advanced, top secret plane, you know, in the world at the time. And to us, it was like, okay, just another airplane, you know. Just
what year again was this?
This was 80 to 84. I worked there.
80 to 84. Okay. And then I see. How does your mind work?
In that sense, in the mechanical sense, I have a great appreciation of mechanical things, and I can just kind of see how things go together and how things are supposed to work. That would probably explain why I never got married, because I'd look at a woman and be like, this thing just doesn't, it doesn't work right. It doesn't, no, what the hell?
It's like marriage is like the bumblebee. If you show a bumblebee to people like you who know how things fly, they cannot explain how a bumblebee flies.
Well, there are two theories of flight, okay? There's what's known as the Bernoulli principle. And the Bernoulli principle is that as air moves faster, pressure drops, which creates lift. And that's the theory that the air rushing over the wing creates a low pressure area above the wing, which lifts the plane. But the other theory is, if you put power behind it, it'll fly. That's the theory that says if you throw a brick, it will fly. So those are the two theories that come together. So, yeah. But, yeah, the bumblebee thing was a poster in the hangar where we were building, because that plane was also the first one that it couldn't fly without the computers. The computers had to, you know, account for the aerodynamics of the airplane. So it literally was like a bumblebee, and like that, without the computers, this thing can't fly. But getting back to women, no, they're beyond bumblebees.
Yeah, marriage is like the bumblebee.
Yeah.
You just have to believe in the honey. Did they ever figure out why a bumblebee flies?
I think it has to do with the speed of the wings, if I remember correctly. But In mathematically, it shouldn't work, but it does. But I think it had to do with the speed that they can vibrate their wings.
Is that how a helicopter flies?
No. You know what a helicopter is? What you think is the propeller on top of a helicopter is actually a wing. It's a wing that rotates. So it's built like the airplane wings. If you could imagine airplane wings spinning fast enough to create lift, that's how a helicopter flies.
You flew today, correct?
Yeah.
What airline?
United. And seriously. I survived. And seriously. You know, I talked about this on my podcast. See, I'm one of these people that's very torn, because I'm a platinum level flyer with 1,000,000 miles on United. Mm. So when you say that, you know, I'm going to walk away and I'll never fly this airline again, I'm kind of vested in flying on this airline. And the other thing, and you know this, David, you traveled. They all suck.
Right.
You know, it's like it's United's turn in the barrel. United didn't do anything that Delta or American wouldn't have done in the same position.
Right.
They just happen to do it. Like they all suck. There's no airline that doesn't treat you like shit.
Right.
You know? So yeah, I'm obviously not happy with them. The CEO did say that they promised they will no longer physically drag passengers off the plane. So we got that going for us, you know. So
what?
Far, Delta and American haven't made that promise. They still have one free drag to get away with.
Well, there'd be no flight. Bernoulli's principle is all about drag, isn't it? What is it like to have 1,000,000 miles?
You know, it's cool. This is the benefit they give you for having 1,000,000 miles. I'll be a gold level flyer for life. So in other words, if I stop flying so much, I maintain gold level. Now, the problem with that is that was great when there were numerous airlines. As they merge, what they don't tell you is, like, when United merges with Continental, now you've got, you know, the 10,000 gold members of Continental and the 10,000 gold members. So your chance of getting an upgrade or any benefit was just cut in half, because twice as many people are in it. But It's good. I'll tell you what I don't know, because let me tell you something. They don't treat me that special, and I'm platinum with a million miles. So I don't know how they're treating you in group four. I think in group four they might just beat you with a stick and tie you in a chair. I don't know. You know, it's like, look, I'm platinum, and they ain't too happy with me. So I don't know what they're doing with you.
How tall are you?
6'3".
How do you sit and coach? And why isn't there a class action suit?
One of the benefits is I get the, I forget what they call it, but the coach seats with the extra leg room. So I sit in that section of the plane where you get a coach seat, but you have business class leg room. So,
but if you can't afford, let's say you're just a normal person without a million miles, don't you have a lawsuit again? I mean,
No. You just suffer. And as a matter of fact, that's being tall. If you're overweight, right? If you're over a certain weight, you have to buy two seats. Seriously, I'm not making that up. I don't know what the weight is, but there's like over a certain size, you know, you got to buy two seats.
Wow.
So you talk about having some money, you know, then it becomes, well, for the price of two seats, you could just buy one seat in business, you know?
Right.
So, yeah, it's uncomfortable at times. And for, if you are, it's not even a matter of being 6'3". I think if you're 6 feet tall and you're in the regular airplane seat, you're going to be cramped, right? Because they've shortened the pitch, like they've shortened the legroom to fit that extra row of seats in and sell those extra seats. And this is why you have this air rage where people are like, you recline your seat that 2 inches and you bang the knee at a person behind you, then they hit the seat and blah, blah, blah. And there definitely been cases of, you know, people getting into fights or coming close to fighting over that 2-inch recline of the seat. And that's where the flight attendants, they catch hell, right? Because some guy in an office, you know, makes this policy, and then some engineer designs it. Oh, well, we can make the seat this much smaller, blah, blah, blah. But then when two people are on a red eye, tired and pissed off, it's the flight attendant who has to try to get between them when they're about to kill each other.
What's the best flight you ever had?
Virgin Atlantic business class. There's two flights I did that were incredible. I did the Virgin business class from London to L.A., and they literally, like, you have to tell the flight attendant, leave me alone. Like, they're just, would you like a blanket? What would you like to eat? They'll cook you in the lounge before you get on the plane. They, like, have a chef in the lounge. Anything you'd like, we'll make for you, blah, 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 blah. That one was incredible.
And back rubs, right? Don't they give back rubs?
They have massages, and they also have a barber. They have the whole thing. I'm not kidding. I'm not exaggerating or making this up. No, they have massages, a barber. You know, you can get a pedicure while you're waiting for in the lounge and all of that. That's all there. A spa. Basically, they have a spa in the lounge. And then the other one I flew that was incredible was Singapore Air. I was doing this gig in Indonesia, and they flew me business class on Singapore. And that's the one where your seat folds down into a bed. Mm. And they put a curtain around you, so you have your like own little private room to fly in. You know, that, and they have, I think they have like one flight attendant for every four people or something like that. Some crazy, you know, ratio of, mm-hmm. Yeah, we're here to take care of, you know, those are the flights that are amazing.
You don't want them to end.
No, then you're comfortable. You're like, yeah, if I flew like this. But then you see the cost of the ticket. And like when we did the Virgin America thing, that was part of a military gig, part of a USO thing. So they donate the seats, you know, as a donation to the USO. But we saw the price of the tickets, and the tickets cost more than we were getting paid to do the gig.
Wow. Yeah. Do you think, because I, you know, I always think about how the environment affects my mood. I often think, you know, if I didn't live in America, I'd be a lot happier. When I go to Canada or Italy, I'm happy. When I come back to America, I'm tense. I'm afraid I'm going to get shot. When I'm on a train, it is impossible for me to be anxious or depressed. I think I could I mean, I think heaven to me would be first class accommodations on a train, just a permanent train ride. I also think the few times that I've flown first class, I think I could just sit on a plane forever and just keep flying around the world. There was a time when you could buy, the rich people were doing this in the 70s and the 80s. I think it was like $250,000. You could buy a lifetime first class seat on American Airlines, which means you could pretty much just live in the air.
Yeah, I don't know if they still do that. I know they do have some of these like around the world tickets. Like you can get on and off planes and go around the world over a period of time. Maybe it's a year or something like that. I will tell you this, that if I'm going across the country, business class is worth it. You know, like if you're flying a 2-hour flight or whatever, it's not that big a difference. It's nice, and depending on the price, I may or may not do it. But if I'm going, like this trip, coming from L.A. here, I did a flight where I had to stop and change planes, but I'd rather do that and get business class than go direct in coach.
Yeah, I'm all about the suffering. I always think, if I could save $300, 6 hours, that's $50 an hour. That's how I figure. I'm making $50 an hour by not paying extra for,
It's funny. My business manager was the opposite, because I used to do that. And she was like, look, your travel is business. Just spend the money. She was like, if you got it, like, so you'll make an extra, you'll make, a few $100 less, mm-hmm. but you'll be comfortable on a 5-hour flight. Just spend the money. So then I started doing it. And, you accumulate perks faster. You accumulate miles and all of that stuff faster. So there are advantages to doing it. But flying, it's the work. You know, when people ask what I do, I like, look, they pay me to travel. I tell jokes for free.
Wow.
That's the gig.
Wow.
Because the travel, and if you talk to anybody who travels on business on a more or less weekly basis, I'm probably in an airport 40 weeks out of the year. And it's a job.
Are you on the road that much? Jon Fugelsang, and I thought I was going to see you on Fugelsang's SiriusXM show today, but you were on it 2 and I was on it 4. And people were calling in to ask to speak to you, and he's been gone for 2 hours.
I love John's show. Yeah. As you know, John's show is intelligent, and he lets you be you, and it's just phenomenal.
But you told him that you're on the road most of the time. Is that true?
Yeah.
40 weeks out,
David,
of the year?
I'm a comic, and I was telling him, in the past few years, I've always been a comic, but it's been more like embracing it. Like, yeah, this is what I do. So, I love when I get a TV spot, you get the occasional acting job or voiceover job, but this is what I do, man. I'm a comic. So I'm not in clubs all the time. I do some clubs. It's a combination. I do clubs. I do corporate. My favorite thing that I get to work with are a lot of jazz artists. I open for some jazz artists. I host some jazz festivals. And I love that because I love the music, and I love mm-hmm. that synergy between music and comedy, right. On a creative level. But yeah, this is what I do. So, I got to travel. It's part of the job. So when I say I'm in the airport 40 weeks a year, sometimes it's just for one night. Like I was telling a friend, I don't even consider that travel. If I fly out Thursday, work Thursday night, and come home Friday, as far as I'm concerned, that didn't even count,
Yeah. Yeah,
but
so
the club
jazz,
weeks are 3 or 4 days.
There are two American art forms that I believe are purely American, and that would be jazz and stand-up comedy. Is that a fair statement?
Yeah, I'd say that's pretty accurate. I'd say that is a pretty accurate statement.
When I was starting out, they used to play rock and roll in the clubs. And I remembered Mort Saul, who started in San Francisco opening for jazz musicians, Dave Brubeck. And I would say, shouldn't you be playing jazz? Because jazz is what gets the audience in the mood to think. And, you know, with jazz, you get a premise and then variations on the theme, and then you come back to the premise, and then you go away and come back, and the musicians will test how far away they can go from the theme and then bring you back. That's what stand-up is. And they would say to me, no, we got to rev up the crowd. Comedy's the new rock and roll. I maintain that had they kept the jazz roots, I never would have had to do a joke about a coffee machine blowing me.
Well, that is the beauty of it. And, you know, you talk about San Francisco, and that was a place where it took place on that level. Yeah, on the creative level, they are the same thing. And what you said is exactly true. Like, it would be great if you have an audience. If you have an audience that gets jazz, they're going to love comedy. You know, creative comedy. I mean, one of the best compliments I got was when I'm just doing crowd work, right? And to comics, it's just fun doing crowd work. And sometimes I test myself, like, how can I tie these things in or doing whatever. And there were a bunch of musicians at the show, and they were like, man, that's jazz. That's just straight improvisation. We love that, you know. And coming from guys whose whole musical world is improvisation, that's a high compliment. But you're right. If you know, I get the rock and roll aspect of it. I've always understood that aspect of comedy. I've always understood the money-making aspect of comedy, you know, put asses in seats, sell drinks, blah, blah, blah. But when you get those rooms, and you know what I'm talking about, where it's just creativity, and the audience appreciates the creativity of comedy. There used to be a room on Vancouver Island, and it was a jazz club during the week and comedy on Friday and Saturday.
Did John Fox book that? And,
I did it with Pat Wilson. Pat Wilson was booking it when I did it. But you could feel it, like, in the room. Like, it had that smoky velvet room feel, like you'd never have to raise your voice, you know, that kind of room. And I loved it. It was just so creative, and that's a beautiful thing. Yeah, it's great when those two come together. And a jazz audience is a great comedy audience, you know, because you have people who want to go past loud noises, people who appreciate nuance and so on. And again, I definitely get the rock and roll aspect of comedy, and you know, any of us would want to be a rock star, right? It's nice to make a few million dollars a year. Let's not kid ourselves, you know. I know a few millionaires, and it looks like a nice life. But from a creative standpoint, if I'm making a good living and I can do the creative stuff and do the stuff that I love, then that's cool too.
Who are some of the best jazz musicians around these days?
A friend of mine, I'm biased, but I think he's brilliant, a guy named Marcus Miller.
What does he play?
He plays the bass, but that's putting it mildly. But just to give you an idea, this guy at 19, Miles Davis put him in his band.
Wow.
Okay, now think about what you were doing at 19. I think about what I was doing at 19. There was no danger of Miles Davis hiring me.
Unless he needed a stealth fighter.
But, yeah, Marcus played with Miles, and then he was Luther Vandross' music director for all of those hits through the 80s. So he did the R&B thing, but he has his own jazz vibe. I'm a big fan and friend of his. There's a guy named Robert Glasper, a brilliant pianist who he has two different bands. He has a jazz trio, and then he has a R&B band called the Robert Glasper Experiment, and he's won Grammys on both sides. You know, so that's kind of brilliant. And you know, then the masters like Herbie Hancock and, you know, Miles, people like that, Chick Corea, I've always loved them. But, yeah, there are some young guys. There's a guy named Christian Scott, who's an incredible trumpet player that I listen to. There are some younger guys, guys in their 30s and 40s, who are making some incredible jazz. And it's very cool because they're using all influences now. Like, hip-hop has become an influence in jazz and vice versa. And that's really cool what some people are doing with that, so...
Do you listen to jazz at home, and when do you listen to it?
Yeah, I listen to it probably more than anything else. I listen to jazz at home. I listen to it in the car. And, that's my music. That's my soundtrack.
In L.A., K-Jazz is such
a... Yeah. The problem with radio, radio doesn't give jazz enough airplay. Yeah. You know, meaning that, like, when you listen to a K-Jazz, they do a lot of the old traditional jazz, what they call straight-ahead jazz, but you won't hear a lot of the fusion or the newer, the more contemporary stuff being done.
I've been I don't know anything about this stuff, but purists look down on that stuff, right?
Yeah, they do, and then they don't. You know, it's and this is what I mean. Like a guy like Robert Glasper, right, who has this electronic R&B band and does covers of like Smells Like Teen Spirit. You know, people are like, oh, well, what does he know, blah, blah, blah. And then he does a duet with Herbie Hancock, where him and Herbie are both on, you know, traditional acoustic pianos. And you're like, oh, yeah, so tell Herbie that this kid doesn't know anything about jazz, because what the hell does Herbie know? You know what I mean?
Right.
So yeah, that's what proves the snobs wrong. When these guys who, you know, like I say, like Marcus plays an electric bass. Right, so you do. Oh well, you know, if you're not playing that a big acoustic bass or this or that, and it's like, yeah, he wrote the song Tutu for Miles Davis. so he's got that going for him. You know what
right.
I mean? So yeah, so the jazz snobs. Sorry, but you know, and the thing about that is jazz was always about improvisation and change. Right? I mean, back in the 50s when they were first starting rock and roll. Those musicians learned how to play from jazz musicians, you know, and that's what they talk about. Like, that's who they used to listen to, right? Jazz and blues musicians, and they transitioned and made it into rock and roll. So there's always going to be a fight for that traditional thing. And the traditional thing is cool, but the music is about creativity and about pushing it to the next, whatever the next level is going to be. I mean, in hip-hop, you look at, you know, it's funny. You got a guy like a Bob James, who's a jazz pianist. Ask Bob if he loves hip-hop. He loves hip-hop because rappers have been sampling his jazz and his funk, and he's made, you know, probably a couple million dollars on the side from, you know, from rappers sampling his music. He's like, oh, yeah, big fan of hip-hop. Love the hip-hop. Love the hip-hop.
Are you a fan of comedy?
Yes.
Can you watch, can you enjoy stand-up?
I like watching people who do things different than I do. And then I just like watching just great stand-ups. Have you seen Chappelle's new stuff on Netflix?
Not yet. I'm backed up.
Yeah, it's great. I mean, to watch Dave Chappelle do an hour is like, oh, that's how this is supposed to be done.
How do you watch stand-up? I was talking to this professor, Corey Brettschneider, who's a regular on this show. He's a constitutional law professor, and he was teaching me how to read a Supreme Court decision. And we've talked about how do you watch Shakespeare? And I always say, well, you got to know the story first so you can appreciate the language and the acting. If you're trying to ferret out the plot, you're going to be lost. How do you approach stand-up when you watch it?
I think it depends on who's doing it. If I'm watching Chappelle, it's almost like I'm a student. You know, I'm like, wow, look what he can do. Look how he did this. Look where he went with that, you know. And then he's got, I don't want to ruin it for you because you haven't seen it, but if you see the special, he does a couple of things where, and you know, the highest compliment we comics can give is like, man, I wish I thought of that, you know. And he came up with this thread that he ran through one of the specials that was like, oh my God, that is so funny, to where by the third time he did it, like all he said was the premise, mm-hmm. and the crowd just lost it because it was an unusual yet brilliant thread to run through a comedy special. You know, then sometimes I watch people like Ollie Long, she just makes me laugh. You know, I like some of the young comics. Some of them are, I don't know how to describe it. There's some of it that I think is fake, and I think it's like the emperor has no clothes. You know what I mean? Like people are acting like this is hip and different, but just for the sake of saying it's hip and different. Mm-hmm. And then some of them I think are really onto something that is really funny and unique. Jared Carmichael is another mm-hmm. one. I can watch Jared. I watch him for his premises because he comes up with ideas, and the way he states the premise is funny, and it makes you think before he starts doing the jokes. You know, so I admire that. And then, like I say, the masters, you know, to watch Lewis Black mm-hmm. do an hour, like, I can't watch Lou too much because I'll start doing Lou, mm-hmm. you know, because it's just, I love it so much. And it's like, I don't know how to explain it. So sometimes I watch as a fan and sometimes I watch as a student.
Let me get back to Chappelle and the freedom on stage. If you're free on stage, and that comes with celebrity or a really kind audience, you can go into areas that you never thought possible. The audience will almost take you there. It's almost like a plane taking off, right? If you have a great audience, is it Bernelli's principle?
I mean, they'll go anywhere with Dave because, you know, he's going to make it funny. You know, Dave is one of the few people that I would pay to watch think out loud.
He thinks out loud, and he would do like 6-hour sets at the Laugh Factory. Can you get there? Are you ever in a city? Are you ever, obviously you are, but I mean, can you just throw out your act and do an hour and just fly?
I do that in the jazz world. I do that in the jazz world because, like, I do these jazz cruises, right? And you know, there's 40 jazz musicians, and I'm the only comic. So the first show I do material, but the second show, okay, you guys have seen my material. It's the same audience. I'm not doing the same hour, and that's where I'll just start playing around, and I'm surprised at how much they'll come along with me for the ride, and I'm just looking for things, and then sometimes you know, it's the other times I love doing that is an empty night at the Laugh Factory. Mm-hmm. Some of my best sets, because that stage is so home to me, and when it's, you know, 30 people, it's like, all right, look, I'm not going to jump around and shout, and we're not doing the set. Let's talk for a while. Let's see where this goes. And I love doing it there. And Dave does the same thing with, you know, 400 people in a club or 2,000 people in a theater, because they know him and they know what he does. And you know, part of that is just trusting you could do it anyway. You know what I mean? Like, I don't think he's ever been one limited by the desire to make the crowd laugh.
Yeah.
You know,
I'm fascinated by this because you're really doing it, and you're out on the road 40 weeks, and you're the jazz audiences. Would you say that the audience is kind of like another instrument, so that you're working with them? It's almost when you're working on new material, you're kind of playing your tune, and then you listen to them, and it's back and forth. It's this great combination.
Yes and no. I think it's more.
Are you there?
I'm sorry. I just had to look at something. All right, something I got to take care of. Anyway, no. I think. I don't know if I'd say they're an instrument as much as it is they will just, they appreciate it. I think it's more their appreciation. So they appreciate you experimenting with stuff, and they're like, oh yeah, that works. Or, oh yeah, that's, you know, or maybe there's something funny there, but I haven't found it yet. But yeah. So I don't think I'm not trying to play them. I'm not trying to make them laugh. I'm just, you know what I mean? I'm just
Are you dancing with them or boxing with them?
I like boxing better than dancing. Yeah, I like throwing jabs. I like throwing jabs, and I like throwing the hook that they don't see coming.
Right.
And knocking them on their ass, you know?
Right.
And they appreciate that. They appreciate the hook that they didn't see coming.
The Marquis de Queensbury, there are rules to boxing. Isn't that the Marquis de Queensbury?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
This is what I remember about you. We did the gala in Montreal. It was a political show. And you were incredibly clean. And I wasn't. This was like 3 or 4, maybe 5 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And your act was immaculate. And I watched it thinking, wow. You have high standards. Do you get pissed off if the person in front of you is doing jokes about their coffee maker blowing them?
Not really. I think, you know what bothers me more? When someone takes a premise and does nothing with it, then they destroy the premise. You know, like take a Ben Carson, right? Because lately I just have fun with this idiot. You know, he annoys me, so it's fun making. But then you have somebody say, oh, that Ben Carson. Oh, what an idiot. Stupid Ben Carson said that, you know, slaves were immigrants. Ah! And then they don't. And now it's like, okay, so now the premise has been trashed. With no punchline or no joke or, you know, yeah, Trump's an idiot. Well, why? Like, give me a reason. Say something. Go beyond stating the obvious. Even though the obvious can get a laugh, take it to it. You know what I mean? Take it to, or don't touch it. It's like if your whole act is, you know, jokes about, you know, sex jokes or jokes about whatever, you know, and then you go into politics, but you don't do politics. So now you're just stating a bunch of premises or words that you've heard before and trashing them. I would rather you do coffee maker blowjob jokes.
Right.
You know, there's not to say that no one should ever do politics or whatever, you know, do whatever you want, but yeah, that bothers me more. I don't. If you work dirty, then work dirty, but don't ruin a good premise with no joke.
Yeah,
that annoys me.
Well, I know you've had a long day, and you've got an even longer one tomorrow. I just want to ask you about the Texas military bases and your podcast, Who's Paying Attention? And I also just want to know if you had any thoughts on Don Rickles.
Oh, three great topics. I'll start with Don Rickles. And, you know, you mentioned the galas in Montreal. 2 years ago, I did a gala hosted by Don Rickles. And truly, one of the great moments in my comedic life, if not in my life period, was getting roasted backstage by Don Rickles. You know, it's on my Facebook page. If you go to Facebook / Alonzo Bodden, it's on there. And Rickles just rips into me, starting with, name's Alonzo. Oh, that's good. You took a white man's name, so the cops won't think you did it. You know, and just goes from there. And you know, David, I mean, is there a more legendary moment in comedy than Don Rickles just ripping on you, you know, with Rickles humor? I loved it. That was great. You know, he's one of those old masters. I mean, we're losing those guys. These guys had one-liners, and they were quick. You know, I was reading, like, there were just all kind of things about Rickles online and everywhere else, and they were talking about, I don't know where he was, but Barack Obama was there. It was some presidential. Oh, yeah, Obama, he was at my house last week. Yeah, you forgot the mop. You know, and who said that to Barack Obama? Yeah, and Obama just falls out laughing because it was Don Rickles. Like, nobody else can say to him, you forgot the mop. But Rickles, bam, yeah.
Well, actually, I remember people saying he crossed the line on that joke.
I don't think he did, and I don't think Barack Obama thought he did.
Okay.
Because the thing about Don Rickles, yeah, Don Rickles, listen, Don Rickles said things that, especially today, you know, that might have been funny in 72 that were horrible today.
Mm-hmm.
but it was Don Rickles saying it. If there's one thing about Don Rickles that you knew, there was never any hatred behind his jokes.
Right.
You just knew there was never. Now, there are some other insult comedians that, and you could tell when they mean it. You know what I mean? And that's when it's not funny. That's when it's awkward and blah, blah, blah. Rickles, if he hated anyone, he hated everyone equally.
Mm-hmm. You know, including himself.
I saw him do this thing. He was like making fun of these Hawaiians doing some weird Polynesian noises. And you're like, now, who does? You know what mm-hmm. I mean? Of course it was cheap and racist, but it was hilarious. And the thing about Rickles, you always saw the person he was making fun of laughing about it.
Right.
I never saw the person that he was making fun of not laugh about it. I mean, he made fun of Sinatra and didn't get killed. you know?
And he was free. I mean, I've been watching him on YouTube for years now, and he was free. I mean, he would go on Carson, and I'd think, how does he fly this way without? And he would crash and get right back up and keep a lot like Jonathan Winters. The growing up, were your parents offended by him?
No. My mother has a great sense of humor. I've always said she might be the funniest person I know. My mom always made me laugh. So she would laugh at good humor. If something was funny, she'd laugh at it. And again, with Don Rickles, there was something about him. And you can tell, you know, the opposite would be Michael Richards, right? Kramer.
Right.
When Kramer went off at the Laugh Factory, the crowd, so you were talking about the crowd earlier as a musical instrument. I've always seen the crowd as like the crowd senses things. Like, you know how they say a dog can sense something? A dog can sense fear or aggression or whatever. I've always felt the crowd is the same way. The crowd knows the truth. And if you crack a racist remark or some kind of remark like that, if you mean it, the crowd knows you mean it.
Right.
And that was what happened with Kramer.
So you're saying when a man stands in front of an audience and screams the N-word 100 times, he means it? Well, I have a theory about
it. No, but I mean, then you see like a Don Rickles, right? And when Don Rickles makes a joke about me going to San Quentin, like, you know, it's come on, that shit is funny. You know, that's like he's not Jeff Sessions, who really means he wants to send me to San Quentin. You know, it's you can always tell, and the crowd can tell. Same thing with jokes about women. You know, women know when it's a joke about women, and they know when it's a misogynist hating women, and so on, or vice versa. When a woman makes a joke about a man, you know. And things like that. I've always felt the audience knows the truth. And with Don Rickles, and you know, I could be dead wrong, right? Maybe they'll find some secret, but I just never felt any animosity toward anyone Don Rickles ever made fun of. I just never felt it.
Yeah.
Never saw it. Never saw anything. Never saw him make fun of one group any more than any other group.
Yeah, I think 20 years from now, 50 years from now, he'll be remembered. I do. I think he will be like a time capsule that holds up and is fascinating. He is and truly dangerous. Truly. Yeah, I know you got to go, and I apologize because I want to ask
you. No, I'm fine. I'm fine with
it. I remember growing up, my mother watched him on a Dean Martin roast. And he said, oh, Nipsey Russell's here. Let me make you feel at home. All aboard. And my mother said, turn him off.
Yeah.
And then 10 years later, I hear this maniacal laughing coming from her bedroom. And she's watching Don Rickles. And just, I think, and that's kind of like the politically correct movement. My mother was being overly protective, but didn't consult the people who she thought she was protecting as to whether or not it was offensive.
Right. Well, another great example of that was Archie Bunker.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Because they always say that All in the Family, like, it couldn't be on TV today. Like, Archie couldn't say the things that he said. But the thing was, when Archie said it, it was so genuinely ignorant that you didn't hate him for it. That's what mm-hmm. made it funny. But now the fat radio guy.
Limbaugh.
Yeah, when Rush Limbaugh.
But the fat radio guy suffices.
Yeah. Yeah. When Limbaugh says the same thing that Archie Bunker said, you know that Rush Limbaugh means it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why it's a hateful thing. And, you know, so, and again, this is where the audience, you got to give the audience some credit for intelligence and for the ability to discern what's being said. So the audience that watches, the same audience that sees Archie Bunker and sees Rush Limbaugh, they're like, oh, this guy's an actor being funny. This guy is absolutely dangerous. Right. Or this guy is saying exactly what I think. And, you know, let me go put my hood on and let's have a party.
Very quickly, who's paying attention?
I love doing it. It started with my look at the media. I think the most guilty party in what's crumbling now in our society, which is intelligence and truth, it's the media's fault, because it's always been their job to hold the politicians to a standard. You know, when Donald Trump says, you know, a few years ago, Syria's a mistake, we should never bomb Syria, the president can't drop a bomb without Congress, blah, 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 and then he does it, there's no one in the media who holds his feet to the fire, who stands up in the press conference and says, now, wait a minute. Let's mm-hmm. not pretend, you know, that so who's paying attention stems from my frustration with the media and the fact that comedians, we're the only ones left telling the truth. You know, as Lewis Black once said, look, we didn't want this job, but no one else will fucking do it. You know, we'd much rather tell dick jokes.
Right.
But since no one else is going to tell the truth, and, you know, fortunately you have people like Lewis and John Oliver and The Daily Show and stuff like that. And, you know, so yeah, that's where that came from. And
you're going off to Texas to entertain our troops.
I love entertaining the troops. The military, I've been fortunate enough to entertain them overseas and here in the U.S., and it is a mutual admiration. They love the fact that, especially when they're overseas, we bring them a taste of home.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and we get to see what they do and actually appreciate what they do. You know, the interesting thing with, like, Iraq, the people who were saying, you know, support the troops, well, we're going to raise your taxes a dollar to help. No.
Right.
No, we can't raise taxes to help the veterans, you know. So to actually get out there and give them a break from their reality for an hour, and every comic who's done it or who does it, we all love doing it. And then the other thing is, we get to make fun of people they can't make fun of, like mm-hmm. their officers or their sergeants or stuff like that. And it's been my experience, those guys have a great sense of humor about it, those guys and women, you know. I mean, not disrespecting them, but just making fun of the hierarchy of the military. You know, and I love entertaining the troops, and it's always been a good experience. And every now and then they let you, you know, play with one of their toys, drive a Humvee or something. They haven't let me blow up anything. I've asked, like, can't we just say it was an accident and blow this fishing boat out of the water? But so far they haven't let me do that.
My two, before you go, and thank you, and we've been talking with Alonzo Bodden. He's at Levity Live in Nyack, New York, Friday, tonight, and Saturday. Two shows each night, correct?
Right.
And what time do they start?
7:30 and 9:45.
Please go see him and go download his podcast on iTunes, Who's Paying Attention? I have two core values when it comes to politics. Medicare for all. That is, you cannot argue with me on Medicare for all. If you don't believe in Medicare for all, there's nothing to talk about. There's just, you're another animal as far as I'm concerned. Medicare for all. And the other issue that I'm kind of becoming almost axiomatic about is a draft. I think that we need to have a draft.
And I get that. I get that, because it levels the playing field. That's something they said, that when everybody served in the military, we all cared a lot more about it.
Mm-hmm.
So I understand that. That makes sense.
And I think it makes us better citizens. We pay more attention. We learn to work together. We also learn to respect and loathe authority simultaneously.
Yeah, yeah. Well, and what's even, you know, loathe it, or at the very least question it.
Mm-hmm.
At the very least question it. That's a good thing. I think values-wise, how great would it be if we, you know, since we're always claiming to be a, quote, Christian nation, like, what if we actually did stuff Jesus would do? You know, like help poor people, help sick people, you know, not hate someone because they're different. Like if Jesus came back now, he'd last, what, 15 minutes?
Right? Especially where you're heading, Texas.
The right wing would be like, wait, listen, Jesus. We know you snuck in here with your peace and love and all of that, but we're going to have to shut you down. You know, I mean, wouldn't it be great if we actually adopted, since we claim to and all that, like if we actually adopted those principles, like honestly, I would hate to be a Christian leader if Jesus shows up. You know, if Jesus shows up tomorrow, I'm be like, hey, Jesus, I wasn't with them. I tried to tell them. I know I'm with you. I don't know what they're doing. You know, I don't think Jesus was building a wall or checking. Jesus never asked a leper if he had coverage. Wait, before I lay hands, let me see your insurance. You got coverage? No? All right, put your legs in the basket and get the hell out of here. Jesus didn't check how much money you had before he turned the water into wine. You want wine? What kind of money you got?
Alonzo Bodden will be at Levity Live in Nyack tonight and tomorrow, two shows. Go to alonzobodden.com for more information. Thank you, Alonzo.
David, this was really fun. I appreciate it. I love the long-form interview and you allowing me to talk and catch up with my friend and be funny.